Hi, Emmanuel, can you see us? Can you hear
yes,
us?
Hi.
Yes, hi.
Finally, we get online.
Yes, sorry, I was just having trouble.
No, that's okay. So, let's start this small conversation.
Sure, yeah.
Right?
Thank you for inviting me, first of all.
You're most welcome. Thank you for accepting our invite. I'll just give you a brief introduction about the show. It is titled In Conversation with Future Leaders. We basically are hosting the show to inspire the world with the achievements of some of our friends around us. Right? Besides the famous personalities, the people who are not famous but still can inspire the world. I was going to your profile, in fact. Pretty interesting profile is what you have. And correct me if I'm wrong, you started your professional career with PR, MSL, right? In Pune.
Yes.
And then from PR to Brandcom, Mahindra Two Wheelers, to again PR, you were the headed. Again, a PR firm, and then you started your own, and currently you're with an AI-based company in UK, right?
Yes. Currently, I represent a company called Zopa in UK.
All right. So, just wanted to ask you, a lot of people from marketing, when they pass out, they typically join a MarCom job, marketing communication. Your first job, you stayed for 4.5 years, was in PR in Pune.
Yes.
And any particular reason why you chose that to join, to start your career with PR?
Well, truth be told, I actually started my career in an advertising firm. It was a very small advertising firm called as Kraftwagen. Again,
all right.
A startup, to be precise. It was just a few friends of mine who said, hey, you know, we're looking at starting an advertising firm. So we started. I was there for like a year. A small advertising firm at that point, we needed a little more than what we actually had within us. So that started. And in between that, PR really happened. I was very honestly a little skeptical to begin with, to get into PR, because I don't know, and I never thought that I was really cut out for PR. And frankly, even today, I don't think I'm really cut out for PR. But I joined it. And there were some very interesting assignments that I was with, specifically with Coca-Cola. We had a very big crisis that had happened. And that got me really interested in PR. And then I continued my journey there.
Okay. And I believe from PR, you got this break into marketing. You were managing a brand. Right. Typically from PR, people tend to go into the field of communication. And I believe from there you got into marketing. Am I right?
Truth be told, I have had a bit of a jump from PR to brand marketing to PR back and to a little bit of communication and then again into whole scale marketing and so on. But, I have frankly taken life as it came to me. There were a lot of different challenges, in a sense, which was laid out to me. And I accepted them when I felt the time was right for me. And if it was an interesting challenge, I kind of accepted them. Some I was good, some I failed, but so was...
Let's get to the first job, because I think this will really help our viewers understand. Now, from PR, when you got into managing the brand Mahindra Two Wheelers, how difficult was that change? Because a lot of people would like to understand that from PR, is it possible to get into brand communication or managing brands? And your next change immediately after PR was with a good brand, Mahindra Two Wheelers, right? So
yes.
I wanted to understand your perspective on whether that kind of career is actually possible, or whether you are just one of the lucky ones, or whether you think people who pursue PR can look at the option of brand communication also as a part of their career, moving into different kind of career options.
Although I absolutely, so when I started PR was fairly in its native or a very starting point as such. Today, PR has, of course, evolved and so on. But a few things that, PR specifically taught me was, particularly two things that I was very, I would say I was lucky in a sense. One was in terms of working very closely with direct consumers as such. So understanding a consumer's behavior and then actually taking that understanding and making it into stories that resonate with the brand was what PR actually is and what PR really means in those times as well as today's times. Of course, in those times, PR was more looked at from the kind of coverages you bought out and so on in newspapers. Even today, to a large extent, it does hold a lot of value. But brands are more and more understanding that the communication needs to be direct with consumers. And for me, it was very important because I was working with very interesting brands like Coca-Cola, like Skoda Auto, and so on. I work with the consumers also very closely.
Yes. In fact, I wanted to ask you that question. Like, you know, you're one of the few CVs which has moved from automobile to e-commerce. And before you moved into e-commerce, you were also with an IT company. Yes. So your career is pretty interesting, from PR to automobile to IT to PR to e-commerce. And now you are into AI.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you look at that was an intentional jump from one field to another, or you just thought basically the marketing still remains the same, understanding the audience remains the same? So you were trying to get different challenges, different fields exploring.
No, so I'll tell you, the actual story is a little different in terms of, so yes, you're right, from automobile, I went into IT, and from IT is when I kind of again, I came in touch with a lot of startups at that point, and startup at that point was just about starting, becoming known in the market. You know, India was just about opening up. There were a lot of startups mushrooming at that point. And that particularly was very, very interesting to me. So I got very interested with startups, and specifically because they were young entrepreneurs. They had a lot of dreams, you know, similar to us. Like, we all have a lot of dreams, but they were willing to take that risk. They were willing to bet a lot of things and not having the legacy that usually brands have, or you know, large enterprises or corporations have. So those you know, young entrepreneurs really inspired me. And that's where I kind of started working with a lot of startups. And that's what got me interested into IT, and then, of course, into e-commerce, which is part of a big startup forum today.
So when you're talking about a startup, what do you think is the most important component to succeed? Is it about the art of marketing, or is it the product, the hardcore product? Because when you're talking about a startup, you either have a technical guy who can create a fantastic product, but he doesn't know how to market it, or you have a fantastic marketing person who can market and sell anything. So what do you think actually is more important? The product as compared to marketing? It is a comparative thing which I'm asking. Of course, both would be important, or marketing as compared to a fantastic product?
So for me, it would be 70-30. 70% product, 30% marketing.
Okay.
The product has to be good. The product has to be innovative. And the product has to be simple. If these things are there with you and it connects with the audience, a great marketing strategy will just enhance that brand, and it kind of will reach. It's the Facebook story, basically, you know, simple product, just helping communities to come on board. And simply, it started off in a very simple way of marketing. It just went from school to school, colleges to colleges. So it's the product at the end of the day. I would definitely believe 70% of the onus needs to be on the product. If the quality of the product is good, then things will work out. And marketing plays an extremely important role once the product is built. And then you kind of, how do I engage with the audience? How do I tell my story? That's equally important, but I still would say 70-30.
So when you're talking about marketing, a lot of people go to media to make a lot of announcements, shout over the rooftop about what their product is all about, rather than trying to go organically about what their product is all about. So people seem to be more in the rush to achieve the great success in the first year itself. And then as a trend, in the third year, they would have collapsed. Most of them, about 60 to 65% go bankrupt in the third year because they would have exhausted all their budgets, fantastic ambitions, but that's just happened between the first 6 months to about 12 months time. What is your opinion about how a startup should look at branding the product?
So you're right, you know, and like I have a little bit of a view out here in a sense that, you know, I work with multiple startups, and the problem with a lot of the startups today, or rather at least now with all this COVID condition, they're actually understanding the value of really creating business. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. Please tell me.
Yeah. So typically around 3-4 years back, when the startup scene had just about kind of, you know, gone big, most of the entrepreneurs or most of the startup community were looking at investments more prominently, or rather they were looking at valuation more prominently than making a very profitable business. And that is where a lot of the startups actually went wrong. It was more important for them to market it, more important to go and talk about, do a great amount of PR, because you get a lot of mileage, which means that you also get a lot of investors interested in your product, and then you get high valuations. And once you get this high valuation, you cannot match up to the actual reality of the market, and then it kind of goes bust in a couple of years. So that was the problem that I feel was there in the startup community to a large extent. Everybody went after high valuations because, you know, Flipkart got such great valuations, or, you know, or Facebook, or any of these very successful startups. And looking at their valuations, everybody thought, I'm a $1 billion company and I need to be valued at that. And that is where I think things went a little bit of a problem. But having said that, I think today, with all this COVID situation and everything, today entrepreneurs are actually understanding how important the value of profitability is, how important the value of actually having cash in your bank is, and which means how important consumers are, and how important I need to continue the business is. And that is going to change, because you're not going to get the valuation that you were expecting, say, a year back. So that's what is going to change.
Since you worked with an e-commerce company in the past, both as an entrepreneur as well as a job, most of the e-commerce companies are running into huge losses, and you still have a lot of investors putting money behind it, as compared to the traditional thought of making profit, and that is why a business was considered to be good. Nowadays, you have a lot of startups, especially in the space of e-commerce. I haven't seen any company which is actually profitable. Most of them are into losses, huge losses.
Absolutely.
And their valuation still runs into millions of dollars. How do you take that kind of concept in today's time, a company running into huge losses, thousands of crores of losses, and still valued at thousands of crores?
It is valued in thousands of crores because it is trying to change a mindset. And I'll give you a little, you know, maybe in value terms. In India today, only 4% of the total retail sector is still only online only. So Amazon, with however big it is in India, including Amazon, Flipkart and all the others, it still is only 4% of the total retail sector, which means imagine what it actually should be. In US today, it is approximately in the range of 25 to 30%. So in India today, with 3% or 4%, it can actually reach 40%. That's the growth that an investor sees is and will come in the future. And that's why it is valued at that. For example, today, again, you know, coming back to where we are today, the situation where we are, what is working the most? And online is working the most. The retail sector is shut. Everything is in a lockdown. So what is actually delivering you what you need in terms of essentials? It is the digital ecosystem that has been built over the last 4-5 years. And that is why it is being valued at that. Certain times I do agree with this valuation, because at the end of the day, you are looking at a consumer base which is around a billion people. And even half of that, or say 40% of that, going online and doing your shopping, you can imagine the amount of business that that is going to create. So it's a long-term view. I mean, look what Uber has created for us. Look what Flipkart or an Amazon has created for us. It's the long-term view that the investors look at. And I think that's the right way to look at as well.
Now, one of the big questions in India that everybody wants to know, and I would like to have your opinion on it, is the war between Jio and Amazon. The latest is that it is rumored, I'm not too sure, but it is rumored that Kishore Biyani would be looking at selling off his food business to Amazon. And this was there, this was written in Times of India also. So I would rather say it's more than a rumor. But the big this battle would be between the Ambani and the Amazon in India. Absolutely. And both of them are looking at going click and mortar. Amazon, if they buy the Kishore Biyani's business, then they're also looking at going both online and offline, a combination of both. And with Jio integrating the entire Kirana stores, I think they're talking about in the first phase, 10,000 plus Kirana stores across the country to be tied down. That's the big battle. What do you think about this big battle, and how do you think the other e-commerce players will get affected, especially knowing that Mr. Ambani has this typical tendency of the huge investment where everybody seems to get in the obsolete zone. And we've seen that happen with Jio as a strategy.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I think the next big fight in the Indian e-commerce space is grocery market. And what the Reliance or Mr. Ambani is trying to, I feel, do is get integrated with the Kiranas of the world, of India, and have a very, very, an amazing ecosystem in terms of supply and demand, both from, a people perspective, because even today, the Kirana is the nearest store that you would visit, even if you have, and Reliance is not everywhere, or rather a Reliance store, or a, and I think that is the reason why, Amazon also is very, very keen on buying or, in some way partnering with the Kishore Biyani, food mart in sense, because it's the grocery market that's going to take the next big fighting, or rather war between the Amazon versus the Reliances.
In the battle between Reliance and Amazon, what do you think will happen to companies like Flipkart? Because even they have a major share when it comes to e-commerce. But these are two biggest giants coming into this field of e-commerce, e-tailing, if I may use, or e-commerce and retail, both. What do you think will happen to companies like Flipkart, or companies smaller than Flipkart also? How adversely do you think their business model will get impacted? Because they are completely into online, while these two giants are coming into a combination of online and offline, and they're coming with other products also to ensure that they have a better reach to customers, customizing solutions and offering much better services. How do you think the impact effect will happen in India?
No, so from a Flipkart perspective, I think this was already seen, and that's why the Walmart, buy or takeover of Flipkart actually happened, because I think they definitely saw this as the next big thing in terms of the grocery market, in terms of what they need to fight an Amazon and a Reliance. And that's why I think, the brothers, the founders of Flipkart basically wanted to get an alignment in that sense. And that's why Walmart happened. But having said that, if you're talking about brands like Grofers or, Big Basket and so on, I have a feeling they will get bought over at some point. I have a feeling that there will be a consolidation that will be required in the market, because as you rightly mentioned in the beginning, there is losses and there's only so much losses that somebody can take. So there will be a good amount of consolidation at the end of the day. But I think that it may not happen in the near future, because when I say near future, I feel that it will still take a year or two's time for a Reliance to actually start buying brands, or an Amazon to start doing that. But I'm pretty sure the talks have already begun and there will be consolidation in the market. So I feel that there will be 4 or 5 big players in the market, which will define the entire ecosystem as such. Not
So when
more
you
than
talk
one.
about consolidation, when you typically talk about consolidation, we have seen a lot of job losses happening, which also tends to affect the economy. Because
Sure.
somebody taking over something, then in that consolidation phase, a lot of jobs tend to get lost. Now we are already hitting a recession thanks to
Absolutely.
Corona. Now with all these things happening, do you think we have bottomed out, or do you think we haven't still bottomed out in terms of Indian economy?
So I mean, I don't know whether I would be the right person to kind of comment on the Indian economy as such, but what I feel, I can definitely say that, yeah, I think we are already in a recession period. There is going to be a lot of, as I would say, rethinking of the business model. But what I feel is that and this I think across the world, this is happening more and more. People are going to start looking within themselves in terms of manufacturing. So what we looked at from taking from a China or from other countries in terms of buying products, or other countries looking at buying products from some other, there is going to be, I feel, a lot of impetus put on internal manufacturing and trying to equate the demand and supply from whatever is made within each country to a large extent. And India has that potential. So while, yes, there will be job losses, but I feel that this, and it might take a little time. So yes, you are right that recession will take a little time. But if you take a positive note on this front, I feel that there will be a change in the way people are looking at doing business. So they're going to start creating products, and for that creation or the manufacturing bit, there will be a lot of jobs that will be created all over again in the country. And that should start, kind of working out for the Indian economy in a good way rather than what is today happening. Because today we are still a very services economy. We need to change that to a manufacturing economy to actually call ourselves more developed. And I think that's what is going to be looked at very important.
I believe you shifted to UK in December, right?
Yes.
Yes,
November end.
Yeah, I'm sorry, November end. So just wanted to understand what is the biggest difference that you have seen in terms of the business ecosystem of UK vis-a-vis, you've also seen the business ecosystem in India. When I'm referring to startups and companies typically falling in the space of MSME. Now, what do you think is the biggest difference that you, if you have to compare with that limited experience of yours in UK, between India and UK?
So in a limited form, whatever limited experience that I've had in the UK, I just feel that here there is a lot of impetus put on quality. That is something that even from a small scale industry perspective, that is very important while out here. Whereas in India, what we are looking at a lot of times is scalability. We want to have scale in whatever we are trying to do. This is, I think, a mindset problem more than, we just feel that we need to create more to actually have more profit. Whereas out here, it's like I would create a certain amount, but I would definitely want to build a lot of value in that product. So hence, that is a slight change in the mindset, I feel. But I would definitely say, and whatever little experience I've had, specifically in the startup ecosystem, I think India is fairly, or rather, I would call India a little above UK. In the way of accepting new technologies in the market. So, like for example, in payment system, we from an India perspective went from cash to mobile payments directly. We kind of more or less skipped the entire card payment to a large extent. Me and you might be using a card to a large extent, but there is a very large population which has never used a card. For them, it was directly from cash to going to a Paytm or a Google Pay and so on and so forth. Now, that kind of jump is possible in India sometimes. But out here, I feel it takes a little more time in terms of the change to happen. I would say these are the few experiences I've had. Of course, my experience is not very vast in UK, so I won't be able to comment that much. But that's what I feel.
Of course, right now it's all Corona all over the world.
Yeah.
According to you, we see a lot of news happening in UK, and I'm sure you'll be seeing something happening in India. So tell me, how is actually the place where you stay, how adversely it is impacted because of Corona? What is the kind of impact, and where, which city do you stay in UK, and what actually is happening there? Because sometimes news, what we see, may not be the actual ground reality. Just wanted to understand how is it, how badly is the city where you stay is impacted?
So I would say that it is quite badly impacted, and more. And I was actually having a conversation with a friend of mine who also runs a very large business out here, and he made a very important and a very interesting statement. He said that this particular unfortunate circumstance that we are in might kill a lot of the smaller retailers or smaller companies.
Yes.
Or you know, the SMEs as such. And what it does, maybe for the larger companies, is to maybe gobble them up.
Yes.
You know, and that, I think, may happen in India as well.
Yes.
The situation is not very good, of course. It's quite grim because everything is in a absolute standstill. And this is not because of the demand, but more or less, it's the supply system that has entirely got stuck. And because of that, the demand, obviously, while maybe there, may not be there, but you don't know how things are going to actually pan out post the lockdown. So there will be a vast change even in the demand format as well. So I think from a UK perspective, I think it's more or less going to be as bad as, or maybe worse, in because India is still a growing economy, right? We still even on a bad, we're still looking at a 2% GDP growth this year, which is what the IMF have put, 1.9 or 1.8. That's still positive growth. Here you're already looking at negative growth, and negative, you know, so you're already looking at a minus 2 or a minus 1 point whatever negative growth. So there is going to be problems, and the issue is also because a lot of the labor communities, or you know, a lot of the people have been furloughed out here, which is basically take on leave. Government will pay, and then once the thing starts back. But unfortunately, businesses are going to look at different ways of doing business because they need to cut costs. So there is going to be a huge amount of unemployment that rises. So yeah, situation is going to be bad for the next 2-3 years till things actually again go back to normal. I feel both in India as well as in UK, but I just feel that maybe the effect will be felt a little more maybe in the West than in India. That's what I feel.
I think I read an article which said about 10% of the businesses will close down. I think Mr. Goenka in Times of India had written this article that 10% of smaller businesses will shut down due to Corona. And 10% is a massive number. Massive number.
Absolutely.
In a country like India, it is a massive number. Yes, so I understand that. Okay, so we've spoken about the economy and we've spoken about Corona also. Let me ask you on your personal front, what is the biggest difference that you have seen in your lifestyle in India versus in UK, with even regards to something as simple as, let's say, buying of vegetables, your daily needs? How different is your lifestyle from India and in UK?
Oh, well,
have you gone out buying vegetables, in fact? Have you actually gone out shopping out there the way you go out in India?
I did that in India.
You've done that?
My wife has always has had a problem with that. But I barely did that in India, to be very honest. India life is very convenient. Maybe once you come to out here, I realize you have to do everything. Lockdown or no lockdown, you still have to do your jhadu pocha and everything at home. So while it's a good life. I would not say that, but it's more. It's definitely the convenience factor. I think that's more in India, and that's what we miss about India to a large extent. You know, the convenience of having your family, the convenience of having help around you, the convenience of just a lot of things.
A lot of things.
In a city, even as big as London, and of course, because we are new in the country as well, we're new in the city, so it's we're still kind of getting used to how things are, and doing things by ourselves, working out a schedule by ourselves, and everything. It's tough, definitely. It's not easy. But it's a great experience. Having said that.
Your wife is working as a senior HR professional with an IT firm.
Yes, she is.
Right? So just wanted to ask you a simple example. When you have both husband and wife working at a very senior position, and when the decision for relocation has to come up, I'm not talking about generally about you, but typically, how does the couple actually handle such a situation? Did you follow your wife or did she follow you to London? As in, who was the first one who got an offer and who followed whom?
So I followed my wife. She's the smarter one in the between us. So she obviously and
is she watching the show?
I hope she is. I don't know. So she's the smarter one and she's the more hardworking one, and she got this opportunity. And of course, when the opportunity came, it was a disruption in our lives. It's not easy when you've been in a country and you've been pretty much familiarized with everything, right? From your job to your people to your family to your friends and everything. It is, it's just that disruption kind of is difficult. And it's an important as well as a difficult decision to take. But we felt that if not now, then when? And we have to sometimes kind of take these risks for, you know, the better or just for us to find out what lays ahead. And that was what the conversation between us was. We basically sat together and said, hey, you know, is this something we want to do? We were very scared. But in the same time, we said that maybe this is a risk worth taking, and let's do it, and let's see where life takes us. And no complaints as of now.
So one thing which I always wanted to ask, of course I've experienced it, but I wanted to give it my audience to know. Then on the streets of India, we have this lot of negotiations happening, bargaining happening. Have you ever bargained the way you do it in India? Have you tried bargaining in UK the same way?
Oh yeah. No.
You never tried, or you were scared, hey, I don't know, how will I be perceived if I were to start even bargaining? Indians are considered to be negotiators.
No, the Indian in us always kind of pushes us to do it, but more than me, actually, it's my wife that I have to hold for bargaining. But we kind of stopped ourselves because it's not the culture here, so people don't like bargaining out here. So they name a price and you got to pay for it.
So this typical habit that everybody is used to in India is, you know, when you go out shopping, you have to bargain because it's a habit.
Absolutely.
Suddenly you're in a country.
Oh, yeah, yeah, absolutely. Oh, yeah. And it's a generation by generation. I think my mom did it, my wife does it. I'm sure a lot of our moms do it. And it's like a very regular thing. They will never take a price at the face value. But here, you don't have that option, so you kind of have to take what price they mention. So,
one big thing that you're missing being in India right now.
Yeah.
What is that one big thing that you're missing?
As I said, the convenience, my family, my friends. Not one, but all of them are as important. My family, my mother. Of course, my friends. We've grown up together, and all of these friends of mine who we've grown up together, I have one of my friend who have grown up together, thankfully in UK, in London, staying very close to us. So he's like a blessing in disguise for us, but that's it. So that's what we miss every day. And we, of course, as well as we kind of miss the conveniences, I said, yeah. We miss our maids, we miss things, A lot. And the food, of course.
And the food. That
Yeah.
reminds me, have you ever entered kitchen? Have you ever tried cooking something for your wife?
I have. Once or twice. One of
That's
them
it?
have. Yeah, it was okay. I won't really pat myself on that, but I'm trying. And unfortunately, I have to now. I don't have a choice. So yeah, we'll be kind of distributing the kitchen weekdays wise. So some days she does, some day I have to do. So that's
okay. That's very nice. That's really, really nice to know that you're gelling well with the changes that is coming around in your life, being because of Corona, because of location, because of job profile, everything. Generally appreciate that. I believe you're aware of our concept of communicator. Wanted
Yes.
to just take your view before we close the show. What is your idea about the importance of communication skills in today's time, both personally and professionally?
People talk a lot about communication skills, but you know, I would personally say that, and one of the things that I feel that we as Indians lack a little bit is listening skills.
Okay.
And if you can listen well, I think you can be a better communicator.
Yes.
And that's an extremely important aspect that people never really put a lot of focus on. So it's very important to hear, listen, understand, and then give the right communication, because it's only then that you realize or you kind of think that, you know, what really matters to the other person can be communicated only when you understand the real problem or the real issue. And that, unfortunately, as a communicator, sometimes we jump the gun. We kind of want to communicate too much, too fast. That's something that I feel maybe should be changed as communicators. So that's maybe one tip that I would. I'm sure everybody, all of y'all, are great communicators.
Yes.
But yeah, you know, if you listen well, you understand better, you'll definitely be a better communicator.
Right. Genuinely speaking, Himanil, thank you so much for joining and accepting my invite to join and answer some lovely questions, candid questions about your personal life also. Appreciate your time invested. Thank you so much, Himanil.
It was a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you.
Same.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.